and it's all about referees. Now, you got to respect a person who, before a tournament, has an article written with the headline, "Will referees' decisions affect the outcome of AFCON 2015? I mean, he even said in that article that no matter which team gets a decision, the other will complain. How often have you seen a team agree with a decision that goes against them? Yeah, well, fair enough. I suppose they will when it's a clear-cut decision regarding a throw-in or a goal kick. But for everything else, they will protest. Why? And he says the answer is very simple. They want to win at all costs. And there are three bullet points that come in there. He says, the players are under enormous pressure to perform. The coach is under enormous pressure to get the result. The National Association is under enormous pressure to secure valuable FIFA ranking points. Given all these circumstances, there's only one person who is going to get the blame. The referee. Yeah, the whipping boys of soccer. He says, the referees are the ones whom every man and his dog love to hate. They're the ones who get blamed for the state of the economy. They're the ones that the bushfires of the United States of America and Australia, and also the floods in the Amazon jungle, all blame it on the referees. Well, he is a former referee right here in South Africa, but he's now based in Ireland. That's a Dr. Errol Sweeney. Good evening, Doc, and welcome to Metro.
Thank you, Rob. Good to be with you.
Well, I think you had the foresight to even predict before the tournament that the focus will be on referees, and look at where we are now.
But it always is, Rob. And as I said in that article for my blog for Supersport, it is the referees, always the referees to blame. No matter what they do, they cannot be right. We're damned if we do, and we're damned if we don't.
What have you made overall, besides getting into the nitty-gritty? We'll get to individual performances in a second, but just overall, we are now at the final semi-final, the second semi-final. We've already seen one happen already. What have you made of the entire tournament's refereeing?
It hasn't been that bad, Rob. Quite honestly, it's not on a par with European or South American refereeing, but that's understandable because everything is down to money and resources. And money and resources mean training and development. The African referees, perhaps some countries, don't have that the money and resources available to them like Europe and South America. Now, therein lies a big problem. Where's that money going to come from? And if they have it, will they even put it into refereeing? Remember, refereeing is controlled by the mother body of each country. So in South Africa, for example, SAFA control all referees, not PSL, not anybody else, SAFA. They are in charge of referees. They're in charge of the training and development. Likewise, in other countries, they are controlled by their mother body. Now, there isn't nearly enough money and resources and training and coaching and mentoring and development, and I can go on and on and on. There isn't nearly enough, even in the so-called Western developed countries. I wrote another blog for another site, and I mentioned there, and I was quoting actually a former head of the PGMOL, which is the Professional Games Match Officials Limited in England, which is currently managed, and the CEO there is a guy called Mike Riley, a former Premier League referee. But the guy before him was also a World Cup referee called Keith Hackett, and he wrote an article saying that English referees at the moment, and I quote, he says, are the worst we have seen, end of quote. And I would agree with him on that. Now, he came out and, or rather, others came out and attacked him from all angles and all areas and saying, you know, you shouldn't be saying that, and et cetera, et cetera. But, you know, we have to stand up as referees. Now, I'm not saying it should be publicized or blasted all over television and radio, but there isn't enough work being put into the referees. Why? I could tell you, but I'm afraid to because it might incriminate me.
You won't be incriminated. Please tell us.
Believe me, there are people listening who are just waiting to have a go at me. But all of what I've said before, there isn't enough money and time and effort and resources put into it. God, I get so frustrated when I talk about things like this. I really, really do. I've been shouting from the rooftops for quite a while now about an independent refereeing body, controlled and managed and trained by ex-referees, totally separate, totally independent, without any influence from what I call these soccer politicians who stick their fingers into pies that they shouldn't even be near. Leave the referees to the referees. Let the referees train the guys. You know, I've also made another sort of analogy. They should be similar to the judicial system in any country, who are totally separate and independent, with no influence from any politicians. And I think if we could get something like that, and I gave a presentation to the AFCON conference last year on this very, very issue, and nobody seems to want to take it up. Now, I don't know why a national body, regardless of who it is, would want to have anything to do with referees and refereeing, because it is such a controversial area. But having said that, and I go back to the English situation again, their monies, their salaries, their wages are paid out of three funds: the FA, the Football Association, the Premier League, and the Championship, which is the second tier of English football. Money is taken from those three people to pay the referees' wages. Now, that in itself, I think, is unacceptable. Because if you pay somebody's wages, you obviously want to have some control or influence over that person or that body. And I think that's where there's a big problem.
And I was going to say, especially within South African context, where there's always been talk, Doc, about professionalizing the industry, making sure that people are better paid. I mean, here you are in a scenario where we watch CNN and we see the world's biggest ringleader when it comes to match fixing, talking very openly about it, and nobody really does anything. I mean, he talks very openly and very blatantly, and now we're talking about allegations of refereeing corruption at the AFCON. I mean, where does it stop?
It stops when referees are controlled by referees and referees only, and then put somebody who's decent and honest and upstanding, put him or them in charge and let them do it. So long as referees are not, I mean, I've heard this as well, and I agree with what you said there. You used a very important word. It's professionalizing the whole system, not necessarily professional, as in distinction between professional and amateur, where guys professional get paid and amateurs don't. That was the old story. But paying guys sufficiently enough to compensate them for the time they lose, their lack of loss of wages, etc., 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 but not making it so unbelievably high that, maybe I'm saying the wrong thing here, but, you know, pay the guys what they're supposed to be getting. There is a theory out there, a school of thought, that says that referees are not getting paid enough, and therefore that's why they're open to corruption. I don't think that's necessarily true. There are lots of people in industry today who are not getting as paid as much as the CEO or the general manager. They're not going to throw a spanner in the works to mess up the system because they're getting a lesser wage than the guy above them or the guy above them or the guy above them. That's not the case at all. Referees are a very rare breed and a very dedicated, hardworking breed. And they do the job for the love of the game. If they're going to professionalize it and pay guys full-time, that doesn't necessarily mean to say that you're going to get better referees. And you know, Rob, this is deja vu. I remember giving an interview way back in 1998 in South Africa, and I was asked the same question. What about professional referees? What about full-time referees? And I say now what I said then. It's not necessarily professionalism that is the issue. It's getting the right people, recruiting the right people, getting them to do the job, and then compensating them for what they want to do. If guys are coming into soccer as referees to make money, well, then they're in the wrong business. They're absolutely and totally in the wrong business. And you can see, and I have to say this, the English Premier League referees today, I agree with what Keith Hackett says. They are not top class. Somebody else says that they're up there with the world's best. They're absolutely not. And again, I wrote in another blog for another site, and I was asked, who would my top 10 referees be in the world? And I gave a list. And I was then questioned and said, but you haven't got one English referee in there, in your top 10. I said, no. And in fact, they wouldn't even be in my top 20. But those are full-time. So full-time salaried match officials is not necessarily the answer. It's getting the right guys to do the job and then pay them. And the money must come last. And if you get the right guys, absolutely, put them up there on a pedestal. Give them the conditions. Give them the salary, because they're worth it. At the same time, if they mess up and if they make mistakes or miss incidents that they shouldn't be missing, I mean, we're all human after all, but if they're missing things that are very blatant, then absolutely demote them and put them down in the lower divisions.
Doc, there was a certain gentleman, Ranjendra Prasad Sekum from Mauritania. He was sent back, and he was sent back home, and he officiated in that Tunisia game, and much pandemonium breaking out there. There was controversy left, right, and center. Let's focus on that game, because there are two issues that come into play. Did he deserve to be sent home?
I don't think so. Now, I saw it was very, very bad footage that I saw. And to me, he's been used as a scapegoat for the soccer politicians who are there. They have to appease the national associations. Now, having said that, I know that Tunisia will fine $50,000 for the behavior of their players and their officials and so on. And I think Equatorial Guinea will fine $5,000 for not providing sufficient security. But what happened to that referee is absolutely appalling. He was attacked. They tried to get at him. They tried to kick him. They tried to punch him. In fact, it was reported, and I don't know if this is true, that the chairman of the Tunisian FA aimed a kick at him, and somebody threw bottles onto the field, etc., etc. That is not acceptable. We must look at the decision he made. Why did he make that decision? And remember, Rob, according to what I could see, which was very hazy footage, he was no more than 10, if maximum 15 meters from the incident, and right behind it. Now, unless they can actually prove that he deliberately gave a penalty to the home nation to get them to go through, then why should he be sent home? It's one decision that caused pandemonium. Absolutely. Why not hit the teams? Absolutely. Why not hit the teams? Can they prove that he was corrupt? Can they prove that he did something deliberately wrong? If they can, absolutely, then ban him for life. Absolutely. And any referee that is involved in any corrupt practice with any game whatsoever or wherever, ban for life. I wouldn't even give these guys any kind of a reprieve.
But if they
can't prove this, the presumption of innocence has to prevail. And I haven't seen any proof from anybody to say that this referee deliberately gave Equatorial Guinea a ban, other than by the decision that was taken by the powers that be out there to ban him for 6 months and to take him off the elite list of referees. What is their evidence? What is their proof?
Because that's what I was going to lean towards, though. But let me get one thing out of you first, Doc. In your opinion, was that a penalty?
It was very difficult, Rob, for me to see it. I have to confess, and I'm not hedging the issue, the footage wasn't great. All I can say is that, in my opinion, the referee gave it for a player being pushed off the ball. Now, it didn't look like he was being pushed that hard, but when you get a former Liverpool player saying that if a player gets touched, he has a right to go down. Now, what kind of mentality is that? What kind of message is that sending out to players? If he gets touched, he has a right to go down. Yet these very same players, if they score a goal, you have two and three, maybe, of their teammates jumping on top of them. They don't fall down. In fact, they stand very upright. So where is the cheating? And who are the cheats? The calling referees cheats? Well, they need to look at some of the players.
Because, in my opinion, if you're going to be sending somebody home for poor performance, was that because of that penalty incident, which obviously benefited the host nation, which are through to tonight's semi-final, or was it for an overall performance? Let's put that incident at the end aside. And if you had to rate him ahead of that incident, would he deserve to be packing his bags?
I wouldn't have thought so. I would call him into a room, I'd ask him to explain his decision, and then I would investigate further. Have they investigated further? I presume they've interviewed him. Has he admitted it? If he admits it, and this is all ifs, we don't know. If he admitted it, he should be banned for life. And I have absolutely no problem with that, and I would be first in the line to ban him for life. If he is not, the presumption of innocence has to prevail. That is normal justice. And he is innocent until proven guilty. To me, they took the easy way out here. They banned him to appease some certain associations, and they sent him home. I'd like to know why they sent him home, for what reason, what evidence have they to ban him for 6 months. You can't ban somebody without some kind of evidence. He's been convicted on what evidence?
And, I mean, that's obviously quite scandalous. And that's why the Tunisians are so angry. They are refusing to apologize. They were given a deadline to apologize. It doesn't seem like they're quite keen to do that because they say that the team overall suffered a scandalous injustice from the referees. And I know that the behavior of the players obviously didn't make life any easier. Their behavior was equally as scandalous, but it was what it was. Though, what then should happen? How do you balance out the things that happen from a refereeing perspective vis-a-vis here, Doc, with the players?
Well, referees are always going to be questioned and queried on their decisions, Rob. I mean, that's going on since soccer was first probably introduced way back in the 1800s. That's always going to be. I mean, the mere fact that you're a referee means that you are an arbitrator. And you're trying to arbitrate between two opposing sides. No matter what decision you make, you're going to disappoint somebody. It's not an easy game. No one ever said it was an easy game. And I absolutely have great admiration for guys who go into refereeing. I know how difficult it is. I've been there. I was assaulted myself. I was taken out of stadiums in the boots of cars and all that. I know what it's like, and I understand the passions and the emotions that players and spectators have. At the same time, most of this trouble is caused by ignorance of the laws of the game. How many know the laws of the game? How many know how many laws there are in the laws of the game? And if you ask most of these people, I'll bet you they don't know. And many years ago, I did an FA coaching badge because I thought I'd like to do some coaching. And you're questioned on four modules. You do four modules, and one of those modules is the laws of the game. And I remember the FA coach telling us at the time, most people fail their badges on the laws of the game. They all know how to tell a guy how to bend a ball and how to step over a ball and all these things, the blah de blah de blah and tactics and whatever, but they fail on the laws of the game. Now, when I was at the PSL, I arranged at the time with Trevor Phillips to go around the different PSL clubs and First Division, ask them, did they want me to come and explain the laws of the game or explain decisions, not to get into a debate over a decision that went against them, but to explain perhaps why the referee made that decision. Four of the, at the time, 16 clubs invited me and not the others. So I think if coaches, managers, players, they need to be upgraded on the laws of the game, what the laws of the game mean, what is a direct free kick, what is not a direct free kick. Maybe if they did that, they'd have a better appreciation of why referees make decisions. And Rob, I have to say, the only people that I am aware of who bring a referee on the panel to discuss these things is Supersport. Nobody else does it. I know Sylvester and Darby does it with the SABC, but nobody else does it. And on this side of the world, I've written to Sky, I've written to BBC, I've written to Irish stations. Why don't you bring a referee on and let him explain why the referee perhaps made that decision? They're not interested. So that would appear to me as if they're quite happy to have the controversy roll on and on and on. And as Sepp Blatter said himself, he doesn't really want technology because he says if you have too many clear-cut decisions that are explained, people won't be talking. Yeah, well, and the only kind of bad publicity is no publicity.
Well, that's how it stands. But very quickly, Doc, we have run out of time. What if I challenge you and say, what if the Doc is just protecting the referees? The referee against, you know, the Tunisia game was simply woeful. He was incompetent and he was, you know, the game was too heavy for him and it was beyond his control.
Well, it can't be, Rob. I mean, he's a FIFA referee and FIFA accredited referee and a CAF accredited referee. So certainly not beyond his ability. If he had a bad game in the day, I don't know. I didn't see the entire game. I looked up the penalty incident. But if he's a FIFA-accredited referee and if CAF thought him good enough, and remember it's a selection process, and there is a Victor Gomez is there from South Africa, but only one. So they pick countries. Is there political interference in this? Perhaps there is. Perhaps they're bringing referees there who are out of their depth. But then why are they on the FIFA panel in the first place? And getting back to my original point, this is why I believe refereeing should be controlled by referees, ex-referees, who would be able to pick guys on merit and on their ability.
All right, great stuff. Doc, thank you very much, as always.
Pleasure, Rob.